right. Finally. There was some really scary technical issues. I thought we would have had to scrap everything. Of course, we are back on the A Show with the Kings of Pro Wrestling Podcast. I am Justin, here with Meelz. What's up, bud?
Bro, I'm completely snowed in. I'm so snowed in that I can't, I'm just refusing to leave the house for, maybe I'll leave it tomorrow. I don't know. So much snow. I haven't had this much snow in forever. It's still not the top 10 most snow, but 18 inches is a lot of goddamn snow.
It is 67 degrees here, so.
Oh, chill. Wow. Okay, yeah, fuck you.
I wish it was fucking cold, bro. I'm tired of the heat, honestly.
Can't relate. I mean, I really can't. I really can't. at all. But let's get things rolling since
Of course, we are on the stuff. Yeah, we are on the road to WrestleMania. Of course, I mean, it's going to be a little different this year, but I mean, it's still exciting in all companies of wrestling, but we couldn't do it without having a special guest, somebody who's never been on the show before. He is someone who is, I don't even know how to say it. Like, you know, when you see this guy's tweets, you're just like, bro, he lives in a whole nother like community of wrestling Twitter, bro. It's very different.
I'll say this. I appreciate him so much because he definitely calls out the bullshit when the Absolutely. Bullshit is presented. And Absolutely. That's for the number of years that I followed him. That has just been kind of like, okay, I fucks with him. So that's been the reason.
We fuck with the truth on the A Show, so of course we gotta show love and we gotta have him on the show. And he is here on the show, finally. Welcome, CeeHawk, to the show. What's going on, bud?
Hey, man, long time coming, man. I appreciate you guys having me on.
One thing I noticed when you and Meelz were talking, I was trying to fix everything. You said you were from Maryland.
Yeah. Family's originally from Southern Maryland. My mother's side, my father's side. My mother joined the military when they got remarried. Her and my stepfather both met there in Maryland in the military. Like, I was born in the military hospital 20 minutes from where my people stay. We moved to Wyoming for a couple of years when I was like 8, and that was horrible. And then moved to Texas when I was 11. So I grew up in San Antonio, ended up going to UT, and just stayed in Austin. So I've been here since 2003. I guess it's the longest places I've lived. So, yeah.
Ooh, interesting. Austin. Interesting. San Antonio is a good wrestling town. Like
tech and stuff in Austin now, right?
It's like what?
A lot of tech. Like the tech is booming out there.
Yeah, everybody moved out here, man. They decided to, you know, ruin the city. I tell people, and I don't say it with pride, but like, I remember in college, you go to the barbershop and they're selling crack across the street, right? Yeah. And now there's a Jamba Juice and a yoga studio and a Subway and a Stericycle and, you know, all that kind of stuff, man. So it's a different world since like I finished college. But yeah, in the last 5-6 years, I've watched like families, like Mexican families on the east side that have lived there for 4 generations, all of a sudden get offered $700,000 for their $75,000 house. And now, you know, you got a parking lot and an apartment building there. Like, it's, man. I don't know.
I would have never expected, I would have never expected gentrification to happen in Austin, fucking Texas. But you know, you're not safe from it anywhere.
They went to South by Southwest one too many times, man, and decided, you know what, we can do it too.
All right, we're gonna get right into No Holds Bar, and we're gonna get into more with CeeHawk. Of course, we got to ask him questions. He's never been on the show before, so we got to you know, run through everything with him. But Meelz, we got some winners this week. The Rumble pool happened in a much at an astronomical rate that I was not prepared for last week.
Absolutely.
We had to do some different stuff.
So there's a bunch of myriad of feelings. How do I feel about the Royal Rumble pool? So the Royal Rumble pool, obviously, we do it every year. Winners are guaranteed a spot on the A Show. You get a guest spot. You can talk your shit. You can chop it up with us, and you know, people will definitely listen to it. But this year, we got so many submissions for the, and sorry if you hear in the background, there's obviously people shoveling and picking up snow, and, you know, New York is trying to do the best job that they can with getting cars out of places. But, yeah, we got pretty much bombarded with a lot of entries for it, and I felt legitimately bad because typically what we usually do is we pick the first 30, and it was like, okay, first 30, two will be selected because there's a men's rumble and a women's rumble, and whatever number you pick, I mean, there could technically be one winner if the same number wins for both rumbles, but you have two opportunities to actually win this. I felt legitimately bad because I was just like, yo, there's about double the amount of entrants, and usually we cut it off at the first 30. So what we did is we did the lottery and we picked 30 out of the pretty much the 60 people that jumped into this. I felt bad initially because I was just like, oh, this was not card subject to change. Not really. But, you know, it ended up working out right. We got two winners. Got to give it up to, first of all, I want to make sure I get his Twitter name right. The_web. Wow.
Long time listener of the show.
Long time listener. Apparently senior researcher. Good for him. PhD. All right. Morehouse man.
He's going to be the most accomplished person academically.
Easily. And then we have another winner, _DonnieSmooth, whose profile on Twitter just says Sushi Boy. So we're getting pretty much all all types. But thank you for both of you guys entering. Thank you guys for listening to the show. And we look forward to having you guys on pretty soon, actually. So that was the results of Royal Rumble Pool. Shout out to the other two because of the whole, you know, lottery thing. Ended up giving away to the people who didn't get entries. Did a raffle for some Uber Eats stuff. Yep. So at least you can eat during the Rumble.
You can eat during the snowstorm, possibly, that you're probably...
Yeah. I mean, you could eat during that as well. So shout out to those who won it. I don't have the names, but I'll shout you out at some point during the middle of the show. But yeah, man, that was it. That was... Shout out to the Royal Rumble Pool. Hopefully we can do some more interactive stuff like that again, and look forward to having, you know, our people on the show this year.
Yes. Let's get into No Holds Barred, our new section of the A Show. Now, Cam, you do a lot of things with PWTorch, so you're aware of a lot of fan base of the wrestling community and how they feel about certain things like the Bullet Club reunion, right? Mm-hmm. So this week, Jay White, who returned to New Japan this week after maybe like a month. Was it like a month? It wasn't even a month. It was maybe like 3 weeks of being of not being on the show. He returned at the Road to New Beginning in Tokyo. And after cutting a promo, he said, "This is the real Bullet Club right here. We're not a cheap ripoff trying to recreate the past to regain some relevance and doing corny reunions just so you can sell shitty t-shirts."
Wow. Shout out to the NWO Black and Silver, but keep going.
So, you know, a lot of people had opinions about that. I've seen a couple people saying things about that promo. A lot of people agree with it because they don't really necessarily like the direction of the AEW Impact partnership that's been going on for the past 2 months. But the Young Bucks Twitter account, I didn't realize they have their own combined Twitter account like the Bella Twins now.
Mm. No, I didn't realize that either. But I mean, honest with you,
they block half of Twitter, so they blocked me. So it was funny when I saw it. I was like, oh, damn, did they unblock me? And I was like, oh, no, it's a separate account. The official account of the Young Bucks said the original Bullet Club t-shirt design hadn't been in the top sellers list for 2 years until the night we all decided to throw up Too Sweet again. You're welcome. Ooh, that's real beef right there.
I don't know.
Maybe we're arguing semantics here. I don't know if it's a big deal just in general, but right. I think that Jay White, you know, saying that, of course, to get over this character, but I think the Bucks might have taken it too serious. And at least that's how I'm reading it, is that they're taking it too serious. I think Jay was in character there.
I feel like
when you start to bring up money, you really mad. Like, that's what it is. Like, no, but I got more money than you. It's like, no, but I'm talking about the art form and like the actual presentation of what we're doing. I think that I'm one of those people who was like never super into the Young Bucks. I'm like, they don't look like they can fight and they don't wrestle like they can fight. But like over the last like year or so, I've really come to appreciate how athletic Matt is. Like, I think he's actually like really good. Like, you, whether you can fight or not, you doing six Northern Light suplexes in a row, That's impressive. You know, those guys are definitely athletes. But I think, yeah, man, they get a little tight when you critique the art, when you critique the edge. Like, they do get a little tight about it. And so, I mean, I feel like y'all are all getting money off them shirts. Like, Hot Topic is sending a check everywhere. But yeah, them dudes can be a little sensitive, man. They are not used to criticism because they developed such a rabid fan base that they got to tune a lot of that criticism out. But when things slow down and that stuff gets through, I do think they get a little tight, especially from their peers.
Absolutely. And you know, they're not immune to constructive criticism. I think there is, whether he's in character or not, there's a lot of truth to what he's saying, because there's a lot of people that are saying the same thing. And I think that, you know, when you have such an elevated place like Jay White does, I mean, a lot of people love this guy, that gets signal boosted very highly. I'm interested in seeing where this goes. I don't know where this goes from here. I honestly think like Bullet Club is tired, but I mean, there's a fan for everything, I guess.
I remember specifically going to NXT Brooklyn a couple years ago, and you couldn't tell, there were more Bullet Club shirts than there were actually WWE shirts. So there was definitely a time where everything was popping, everything was moving. I'm not sure how the money shakes down or breaks down from there. If you're, you know, how whatever member of the Bullet Club you're in, and it's like, okay, do I get like residuals from this, or is it like just an only people who have trademarked the name or something like that? But just a couple of years later, man, like honestly, yeah, the Bullet Club thing is tired. Everyone's kind of need a new name. I think everyone has established themselves at their own right. I'm surprised this was still like a talking point in 2021. Yeah. I don't even know, like, but it is, you know, it is what it is. I think the reunion, you know, as Jay White says, corny, but hey, you know.
Man, how much is Finn getting broke off? Because that was his thing.
Yeah. Yeah, you wonder that. Is AJ getting a little small check on the side? Like, and I think what's hard about it is, like, you know, AJ financially is probably in the best position he's been in. You know, he's kind of in that late 2000s or Chris Jericho position. You know, we can put you in a title match if we need to. If not, you'll take care of the other things that we need done. You know, Finn has gotten some of his passion back being at NXT. You know, I don't know. Y'all may know better than I do, but I don't know if his check's gotten any smaller being at NXT. So if you get to travel less and have better matches, like, word to you, that's cool. But I think that it being a newer promotion, those guys having so much say in the direction that they go, you are inclined to, while you've been doing new things, you're inclined to go with what you're familiar with. What are we familiar with? Anderson and Gallows. You know, What are we familiar with? This pose, this conversation, this aesthetic. So I do think that that's there. And of course, there's money to be made because they're going to have those people who are always going to buy that merch. But I think that, not that they're in a rut at all, because they're doing some interesting things on Impact with them and Omega and these kind of tenuous alliances. But yeah, I do think sometimes when things aren't going at full speed, you are kind of like, okay, I know I can incorporate this, and this will buy us some time until we work on the next thing.
Yeah. All right. A little bit of a bummer news here, but I'm glad he's okay now. Rey Mysterio revealed in a recent interview that he and Dominik had COVID in December, and that's why they were off TV. I think I remember asking a couple times, but I don't think we ever put two and two together there. And I think it sucks that we have to, you know, when someone's out, we're never going to the first, like, oh, God, they got COVID. And I think that's one thing with Ray, like, we just didn't think that he had, but he revealed that he and Dominik, they were out for quite some time due to COVID. And, you know, it really sucks. They're back now. Thank God Dominik was in the Royal Rumble. But, you know, again, it just shows there is a consequence for what these companies are doing right now, regardless of how much entertainment it brings us. I mean, we're able to do this show every single week because of it. There is a consequence here. And we've seen this within the last month with Drew McIntyre, with Rey Mysterio, with Dominik. And it probably explains why Aaliyah isn't back as well.
I'm going to keep it a stack. I really thought there was, at some point, it was Rey Mysterio's birthday. And he was like, oh, I'm not on SmackDown this week. I was like, you know what? Fair. Because I wouldn't show up to work on my birthday either. And then a couple weeks after that, I think it was like close to Thanksgiving, I was like, oh, he must be taking the holidays off. And then a couple weeks later, it's like, well, Christmas is right there. Like, if they don't need him, like, why even bother showing up? So I had no idea he had COVID at all, because I just assumed they were all taking off the holiday. It's like, it's Rey Mysterio at the end of the day. Man is like 30 years in the business, I'm assuming at this point he can kind of call his shot and be like, yo, like, you know, I know I'm in this feud with Corbin, but like, y'all gonna be all right for like the next 6 weeks, right? Because me and the family going, you know, this, that, and the third. So that's what I assumed. But to hear that it's COVID, it's like, oh, wow. Yeah, that probably makes way more sense.
Bro, what are they doing? What is any company doing to stop that? Like, I mean, you see the NBA going through it, NFL going through it, MLB just went through it. Like, this is something that's going to be a problem. And, you know, I hate to keep banging on this drum every single week, but like, this shit is serious, y'all.
But there, so, you know, there's like, Dominic was definitely in somebody's line waiting on them Jubilee 11s. you know, touched the, like, dapped up the wrong dude in the Bape hoodie. Next thing you know, he coughing at the house. Like, that is one danger. And, you know, we saw with the Rumble, you know, with, you know, Mia Yim and then possibly Keith Lee. Like, I don't know if Keith Lee actually has anything, but contact tracing and just being in close vicinities, you know, it's great that Ray was able to get the family a check, but then you run into issues like this where, okay, I caught something, we're in the same house, at the very least we're traveling together everywhere, and then we're all out. Yeah, it's scary times, man. Like, you know, one thing about being on Twitter, when you say, wow, WWE shouldn't be running live shows, people immediately respond, so you're okay with AEW like having live shows? I'm like, no, stupid. Nobody should be having them. Like, think for a second. But yeah, it's all these people going to be at the Super Bowl. Like, and the issue is, what's the biggest issue? We pass these things off as if they are normal.
Yeah.
We watch the NFL talk about the precautions they're taking. Then they cut to a guy wearing his face mask like a chin strap. Like, we have done this thing to normalize something that is just taking the lives of so many people each and every day, and stuff like this happens. And it's to the point where, like, Rey Mysterio had COVID in December. If we knew Rey Mysterio had COVID in December, we'd be worried about Rey Mysterio's life. But they tell you a month later, so that then you're like, oh, well, I guess it was okay. Then you think the next person's going to be okay, and the next person's going to be okay. Like, it is a scary time that we live in, where this thing that is life-altering, we're just like, eh.
Yeah, and that's why it was so shocking that Drew came out, and even when he got back, continued to say how serious of a virus and a disease this is. And, you know, like, even when Drew said, you know, I lost my sense of smell, I was like, motherfucker, you lost your sense of smell? Like, I'm not going back to work. You know what I mean? And you know, kudos to them for, you know, having a job and being able to do what they love. But again, like you said, this is very serious. And, you know, Ray, he's not getting any younger, and he's falling into that age where, I mean, not even that, like, Ric Flair is on the show too. You know, there's a lot of people that fall within that dangerous, severe age of, if they were to catch COVID, it would be very serious. And, you know, again, no one should be running shows, much, much less, you know, WWE, but just announced that they're going to have fans at WrestleMania this year. Fans, both nights. Just think about that. Like, again, it's being normalized even before we even get the vaccine to everyone. And that's just really the main problem with everything.
Absolutely. And it's kind of like being angled, sort of like, we got to get back to business. We got to restart the economy. We got to, you know, we can't be afraid of this entire thing. We have to, like, move forward and continue to push forward. And it's like, bro, it's not over yet. Like, it's still not over. And in these situations, I don't think at any point people are going to continue getting COVID unless there's a bubble in wrestling, which would never happen in my opinion. I mean, who knows? But, unless there's a bubble in wrestling, or they just stop doing it altogether. The mere factor of traveling to somewhere else with people that you're not fully sure what they've been doing for the last, you know, 30 days or even 48 hours, something like that, it's just, the situation's always going to come up. We're going to be going through Mania, and someone's going to be pulled off the Mania card because they got COVID. Like, it's going to continue happening for the foreseeable future, and it's unfortunate. But WWE has decided, like, yo, shit, we got Peacock content to fucking make, man. Like,
we got documentaries to make.
Yeah, like, that's what they've decided. And it's not even just WWE, because, you know, it's all companies moving forward. All companies who can at least sustain it. You know what I'm saying? Who can sustain having no fans and still having a show. or who have television deals, or et cetera, et cetera.
Yeah, I was asking, I was asking AJ Gray, like, you know, you're doing these shows like during COVID, and a lot of times they're closed. Like, how jealous are you looking at Japan, knowing that they kind of took the right precautions when they were supposed to, and they just got people at stuff? He was like, no, I definitely feel that. Like, it would be great to have people around and to feel comfortable with it. And so, yeah, it's you know, that devil may care attitude got us kind of here, and we have to worry about these things every single week, every single show, if somebody's going to pop up, you know, testing positive or not, and what that's going to adjust. And of course, we're worried about their safety more than anything else, but it also affects the TV. All of a sudden, they got to write stuff off or write new stuff in, or in the event of a big thing like the Royal Rumble, all of a sudden you got a ring full of white dudes at the end of the match when you know that's probably not how it was drawn up, you know?
Absolutely. Yeah, absolutely. And it affects situations like, I haven't seen Murphy since. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
I don't know if he's been affected by this. I don't know where his kind of push kind of lies, if they still like want to incorporate him in this entire thing. It's actually a big question. I should probably like look myself. But yeah, Murphy, I mean,
you've been tweeting.
Oh, so you've been tweeting?
Yeah, he's definitely at home, but yeah, but not on the shows. And you know, I'd like to chalk it up to SmackDown having too many at the top and too many in the middle right now, but Murphy absolutely needs to be on that show. So I'm hoping he's okay too.
Absolutely.
Let's get into Royal Rumble discussion. I thought it was a good show. I thought it was actually really
good. I don't know how I feel about it, to be honest with you. Like, it's weird. I'm in a weird state of where, especially after watching a lot of past Rumbles, and maybe it's that fact of that, like watching 2019 and watching 2017 and just being like, wow, this was amazing. And then watching this year and then being like, oh, Goldberg. Okay. I mean, like, you know, there's a bunch of things that kind of went on with the show. Actually, Cam, I would like your thoughts on kind of like, that opening contest, because we've had, you know, Drew versus Goldberg, a match that we actually took bets on terms of like how long it was going to actually last. I'm just going to assume Ernest won. He's the one who won without going over, I guess. The closest without going over. So I'm going to assume he won. But what were your thoughts on that match?
I think like when it first finished, I tweeted, it wasn't any good, but I didn't hate it. You know what I mean? Like, it was, nothing's ever going to be as good as Brock Goldberg. Like, mm-hmm. I always call it the shotguns in a closet match, because
right. There's
no space between the guys, but they're hitting every single move they can because they know it's going to take just that one to get the job done. It was so fun. But, you know, that was like 3-4 years ago now. Like, there's really some time between now and then. So you get older, you get rustier, you can't have that exact match with every guy, because as big as Drew is, he's not thick in the middle like Brock is. And so mm-hmm. It just changes up a lot. But I do think that they did a good job of hiding Goldberg's weaknesses. I think you let him hit those spears. I think that Drew, being so athletic, you know, I was impressed by how Goldberg was selling those kicks. Like, right. Goldberg selling a Claymore, I thought was good. Like again, it's nothing that you're going to revisit. It's nothing you're going to tell your friends they need to watch. But in the interest of protecting your legend and making it look really, really physical. And then even at the end, it's not like a love fest between them. Like, oh, Drew, you've earned my respect. Or, oh, Goldberg, you're one of the greats. It's like, hey, we went out there. We did our thing. We both got through it. Salute. Like, I think for what it was, it absolutely worked.
I'm still, like, shocked that this man, obviously, he takes this 100% seriously, but to consume 16,000 calories per day to go and wrestle for 2.5 minutes, I'm just like, wow, you take this way more seriously than probably your peers would, because I think anybody else would have like grabbed a t-shirt. I mean, even the shorts didn't look that great. Maybe he's getting in, like, maybe that's the kind of like the compromise that we get here is like, he's not wrestling in t-shirts, but he's wrestling in, like, you know, ball shorts or like whatever.
They iron that patch on. Absolutely. Like, backstage before the match, they cut it out. Everything.
Man, it looked like he was wearing some Fear of God Essentials shorts, man. Them shorts are baggy as hell. I was like, oh, I got those joints.
I feel like we're going to get a new story of like, I wasn't supposed to be wearing those shorts. And then last minute, my tights like stripped or whatever. Like,
Yeah, it's definitely weird to see him, because like I feel like there's diminishing returns, and that's why he's being so crazy about it. Like, I don't work out. You two work out clearly. Like, is it like, can he sustain this for very long if he keeps coming back and like keeps like going crazy? Then okay, I'm gonna cycle off. Going crazy, then cycling off.
Your heart doesn't work like that. Like in all seriousness, like, could he do it? Yeah, he has the money and the means to find those foods, but no, your heart cannot take that. Like, 16,000 calories a day, like, you just have to do so much. And at that advanced age, you know, like, the thing they don't tell you, I mean, that everybody knows, like, let's say Goldberg never did a steroid in his life. Like, let's just say that. We're still talking about 25, 30 years of heavy weightlifting. You know, like, Vince McMahon shouldn't be able to walk doing deep squats like that into his 70s, you know? No. It's not sustainable. And credit to Goldberg, for him to be that slim in his waist at this age is really impressive. Like, I mean that. He's able to maintain like a facsimile of what he was before, but no. This is not something you can just keep doing. It's going to be really interesting when Braun looks like in 10 years, because his physique is crazy to be that size. Yeah, the slimmer guys hold up a bit better. Triple H is somebody who's never consumed like liquor or drugs and doesn't smoke or anything. So he has kind of a leg up to where his body's going to hold up longer than it should. But, you know, Goldberg's a regular guy. No. This is not something that, if he ever looks as good as he does again today, I'll be shocked.
Even like Ric Flair, right? Like, Ric Flair has like, He was a definitely strong guy back in his day, but he's not to like the level of Goldberg, like body guy like that. And then like even like in his 50s, I guess his body just kind of like turned to rubber and just kind of just started absorbing all of the blows or absorbing bumps. Mm-hmm. Or maybe he's just conditioned to it for a certain amount of time. Because anybody who falls out of a plane, breaks their back, and can still kind of wrestle is just like, wow, you're just...
Ric Flair was living off the soul of all the women.
They say Ric Flair's apocalypse, man. Like, he's just always going to keep coming back, like, in different forms. But he's like the reverse apocalypse, to where, like, back then he looked like he was the year, you know, 2010 with all that great cardio. And now he's like hieroglyphics apocalypse, you know, just kind of holding on. It is just, like, I think there's a few guys, like, and I don't even know if he'll come up, but John Morrison is just the most impressive, like, physique maybe that I've ever seen in wrestling. And the biggest part of it is like, he's kind of had that body with those crazy abs for like 15 years and still has it. He is the most fit jobber that is ever going to be produced. He's a magician. But no. Goldberg, a reason a lot of these guys last so long is because they would do things to adjust. Like, Hulk Hogan, for as big as he was never super chiseled below his chest. But you can keep moving that belt up, keep tanning, and keep doing curls. And Hulk Hogan was Hulk Hogan for as long as he could be until that back gave out. Like Goldberg, Brock, you know, they are always going to kind of be big like that. But yeah, Goldberg, I was watching some 1997 Goldberg over the weekend. And yeah, it's you shouldn't still look like that, you know, 20 plus years later. But, you know, the fact that he does look as good as he does, it is really impressive.
Now, we talk about Goldberg. And Cam, I know that you've had a very long argument, or not even an argument, but discussion about this for the past month and a half, especially.
No, I feel like it's been arguments with people. I feel like I've seen it.
I don't know what Cam will call it. I'll call it disagreements. Okay, let's keep it in the middle about part timers and people that are older coming back to the biz, and some people not keeping that same energy. Now on Royal Rumble this year, you had two part-timers or two older talents coming back and really kind of, you know, starting it and bookending the show with Edge and, of course, Goldberg. How do we feel about Edge winning the Royal Rumble as a whole? Like, and as well as, I mean, just away from Goldberg, you know, being an attraction. Of course, he lost. A lot of people were thinking he was going to win. I was like, how the hell are you going to what story are they telling if Drew loses to Goldberg here? But how do you guys feel about the, you know, Edge winning? A lot of people were upset about it. You know, you got Sting wrestling literally this week on AEW. Like, what is the feeling of having a 47-year-old win the Royal Rumble this year?
So my thing with Edge was always Edge is in his late 40s at this point, right? But Edge didn't retire because he was washed. Edge retired because he was hurt. I'm kind of okay with person returning from injury being put into a top tier position more so than guy who stepped away and was on the autograph circuit all of a sudden coming back in when they, you know, the last time they left, they weren't any good at that point either. Like I love like when somebody's nice enough to let me on their platform and it's probably like their audience has had some experience with me talking about Sting because I'm always like, I don't hate Sting. Like I don't have any ill will towards that man. I don't think that he has any ill will towards anybody. My thing with Sting has always been this. You did your very best work in like 1995. You got put into a more prominent position with this great character, but you sat around and got out of shape. You did some pretty decent stuff in-ring wise with the Wolfpack right at the end of WCW, but you were past your prime in 1999. Like you just were. And people loved your character, but you can't ask a Crow Sting fan their favorite Sting match. They don't have one. You know, that's not what he was doing at the time. Like, even though I have one, I think Sting DDP US champion challenges world champion is a fantastic Monday Nitro match. You should go watch it. But no, like Sting, the character is what they loved. And so to see Sting, you know, even in TNA and then in WWE and then getting looks in AEW, I'm like, look, I'm not mad at the man for getting his money, but you should be if you like him because he is there to get the check. He's not there to make you feel good. He's not there because he thinks you want to see him. He's not there to bust his ass for you. He's there to get paid. If that works for you, fine. But, you know, like all due respect to Sting for getting that money. But, you know, you guys are lying to me about Sting, which is fine. But lying to yourself is wrong.
I love this. I love all of this. Listen, I'm not the biggest fan of Sting. We call him Stink over here in the A show.
He calls him Stink. I really have nothing against Steve Gordon.
We call him Stink over here. Steve Stink Gordon.
But I absolutely stinks the day he showed up in WWE, by the way. Listen, I remember this specifically.
I don't know how you could look at what Seth Rollins did to him. Listen, that's my favorite Sting match, by the way. Seth Rollins Sting.
Honestly, this is where the disrespect comes from. Okay.
I don't see how you could look at what happened to that man running when he fell on his face, his neck turned into Pringles chips. How you could be excited for what's about to happen this Wednesday. Now I don't want to touch too deeply into that, but I do like the point that you made about Edge is that he had to retire because he was hurt. I think with Edge, and we'll talk about this with Raw, there is a compelling story there with him coming back like Rocky and, you know, just seeing if he can still hang with the younger guys. I think they should absolutely, and they've started the story on Raw, like showing Edge can't hang like that anymore. He's limping. He's hurt. Like the story is, can he get one more match? And that is what intrigued me about it. I've seen people say it was like a rerun or it's a rehash. I'm like, this is markedly different than the last time he won the Royal Rumble. And I think that there's a better story to tell here. Almost low key, it could be better than the story they told last year with Orton, with Edge coming back and having to deal with all these adversity and all of this adversity going in.
It's exactly what you're saying, though. It's not legend returns and can current star compete with the aura and the will of the legend. Like it's not Rock Hogan where, again, Hogan was infinitely past his prime. Rock was at the height of his powers and they go straight up. You know, it's not that. It's and the great thing about Edge is even though he wasn't always written as it, like Edge is just really the ultimate underdog in that Edge's peak was when John Cena was there. And Edge was, I think Edge is still John Cena's best rival. Absolutely. Because Edge was like, I'm all the things that you're not. I really do have to scratch and claw and manipulate the system to where it works for me. And I hate you for that. And so Edge getting in Drew's face, and I know we're going to get there, but Edge getting in Drew's face like, yo, you the champ. There's a target on your back. Like, I love the idea that the story is literally does Edge still have it? Not can these new people compete with the past generation? I love it. It's Edge. If nothing else, they've always made Edge human, for better or for worse. And, you know, I think that he has, you know, those eyes being so deep in his head, man. Edge just has that look about him like, if this is, and it's not even a knock to my man, but if this is my last day, I am going to go down fighting. I love it. Edge has always been, since he's been a heel, Edge is very much about desperation and survival. Right. And will do what he has to do to make that happen. And it comes across in the things that he says. Now, the in-ring stuff got to get better between now and then. He has to, you know, kind of make up for that. Because whatever Edge lacked in technical prowess 15 years ago, the intensity was there. The way he pulled that hair back and stare was there. The speed with which he could move was there. So that stuff got to come back. But yeah, it's better than the bullshit they try to tell with Undertaker being the last outlaw and does he still have it? That motherfucker was still had smoke and mirrors and bats coming out and rise from your grave like altered beasts. Like that was all still there. Edge is just Edge. Like I do like that.
Right. And I think, you know, I love the story of Edge winning the Royal Rumble. And I get the story. And I get like, okay, you know, his last match before the World Championship, trying to regain that sort of form of glory and all the other stuff that you can kind of tell as a veteran, as someone who has completely been outside and trying to work their way back in. My concern is the health of Edge. My concern has always been the health of Edge. And I love Edge. He's still one of my favorite wrestlers, period, because he just attacks it from a different angle. He attacks wrestling and his persona. And I think there's a little bit of an artistic side within him that kind of like fully appreciates the art of pro wrestling as opposed to just, you know, the business of it. But I do think overall his main problem has always been staying healthy. And you can even see like in this like second match back, he gets hurt, which was kind of it's a telling thing of his career, right? Because how many times, like you look at, you know, Undertaker was on whatever show talking about all his injuries. Like you look at Edge and it's like he's torn everything possible. So how do you get to, and then he's on Raw having like 25 minute matches, which is like, it's cool. I get it. I don't think it was necessary. I don't even think it's to the point where you even want to put him in that position where he's having matches frequently on regular television shows, because he's just at any point it could, because of that intensity, because of all that stuff, and anything could snap, anything could break, anything could tear. And the last thing he wants is like to go into WrestleMania hurt, because he will still want to go into WrestleMania. He will, you know, torn tricep. He's just, returning from that, a bunch of different things. That's always been my concern with Edge. And it's amazing that, you know, he hasn't wrestled actively for the last decade and he was still managed to go a full 60 minutes in the Royal Rumble. I think that's impressive. But just, he's just so, I don't want to say brittle, but it kind of, when you look at, because it can feel demeaning. The last thing I want to do is like, you know, insult him. But at the end of the day,
it's like, don't worry, he can't hear this.
He will. He hears everything. He heard our WrestleMania review of his match. Like he heard everything. But he's just so injury prone in these type of moments, and I can't imagine him continuing to move forward at like having matches on Raw and continuing to be a presence on the show, and it's still working somehow. So
yeah,
You know, that's my only concern with this. I think we'll get to the story. And it's also, sidebar, his hair. I was like, man, you need healthy, like, throw something in it, something. You need Shawn Michaels. Shawn Michaels oil or protein, something. Like, it's thinning bad.
Who do we think, okay, right, real quick before we go to break. Who do we think Edge is picking? He doesn't pick on Raw, but who do we think he's going to pick?
Roman?
I say Roman. Yeah, I say Roman. I think that Roman telling him you ain't got it no more is bigger than Drew saying it. I think that Edge, like, you want your Royal Rumble winner to go into, and at least on with the men, you want your Royal Rumble winner going into it with a heel, because it feels like they're accomplishing something and you're not diminishing what Drew's doing on his side. I think that Roman at this point is, he's so made, and like, it's been what, 6 months? Yeah. He's so made. Title, no title, Roman is that guy. And they ain't even got to keep the thing on Edge for very long, but you can get that moment that people want to see. And I just think that you can do things with Roman that don't involve matches. You got the Usos sitting back there, Edge having different people to interact with on SmackDown. Yeah, I think Roman is the money match.
I agree. I absolutely agree. I for all those reasons, but also because like Edge is very story based, and if he knows he can't go in the ring like a Seth Rollins or something right now, he would do really well with Roman cutting those 5-minute promos in the ring, talking about his kids and his wife and paying his rent and shit like that. Like, I think that is the way to go, especially if you're able to still have
his rent. You don't got no damn rent.
Hey, I don't know how Edge living. You see what he did to KO? I'm mad about that too. I'm mad about it. I'm not really fucking with Roman right now. I'm mad about that.
So let's just we can talk about the rest of the Royal Rumble event as well. But definitely that Roman versus KO match, because it was something where this was absolutely the last chance for Kevin Owens by far.
I don't believe nothing he about to do. After the loss, he could probably get beat by a Grand Metalik, and I'd be like, yeah, that makes sense.
Listen, the way Kevin Owens, I mean, I think everyone saw it coming, because obviously the plan is like Roman for Mania. But and then like the best time, we've talked about it so many times, the best time was probably like a month ago if they want to drop the belt, do a quick switch and give it right back to him. But to me, I agree with a lot of it in that, like, damn, we really like kind of like hold out Kevin Owens like 4 times in a row. Like, and the crazy thing is like his character can absolutely take it. But, like, why do we want to continue kind of doing that when we're continuing this process of, like, creating an atmosphere, especially on SmackDown, where the main event scene isn't truly a scene. It is Roman and kind of, like, whoever.
Yeah.
It's Roman and, like, at some point, the main event scene was Roman Reigns and Jey Uso. So it is definitely, like, it's definitely, like, there's a problem on top on SmackDown for all the good things that are going on SmackDown, which is a really great and breezy show to kind of watch. There's definitely a problem on top in terms of like not establishing a scene or contenders or people to come after Roman eventually. Like WrestleMania is going to finish, and then where do you have from there? And just kind of, you know, throwing Kevin Owens to the wolves. It was an entertaining match. It was a great match. I didn't like the finish, but hey,
it's because they botched the finish. That's why the finish was tough to watch. Paul Heyman, what are you doing?
Yeah, I don't know if they're going if they're going to do more now that the Royal Rumble's over and you have stuff to get into in the summer. But to me, it made sense to have Nakamura come out when Adam Pearce said subject to change, just based on what they built like the couple weeks before. You know, I think that Kevin Owens, the thing about him is, like you said, they hold him 4 times, but they literally hold him 4 times. Like, they came up with random wonky finishes or interference or things as to why he lost. And so, you know, he's I remember somebody, my man, my big homie, the wrestling otaku, was like, had a 30-second YouTube video. He was like, Kevin, for yourself, for your career, for your family, you need to go to AEW. Nigga, for what? You mean to tell me 4 straight main events with Roman Reigns is like, that's the sign you need to jump ship? Like, that's the new creative direction for you? That's the dumbest shit I've ever heard. If for no other reason than, like, you're in the main event. Are you winning it? No. Have you won it before? Yes. Do you get to say you're a guy who challenge Roman Reigns and defended against Goldberg and competed with Rollins and was one of the most decorated NXT champs, like, and headbutted Vince McMahon and got a payday with Shane McMahon? Like, so many good things have happened to him that when the bad things happen, sometimes we tend to forget them. And then the bad things ain't really, really, really bad, you know? But with all that said, I still think that's a spot where your story allows you to throw a Nakamura in there and maybe save KO a loss, but he's going to be good going forward for sure.
Yeah, he is. I want to talk about Bianca Belair. I know we're all happy. We could talk a whole hour about her, but who do you think, who where do we think this is going? There's reports, and I know, you know, you use this, you consider these with a pinch of salt, grain of salt, rather. They're saying that they don't know what they want to do with her. And I think that they absolutely know what they want to do with her at WrestleMania. But what do we think, you know, where do we think the direction is going to be?
It's got to be Sasha at this point. I mean, so just because I don't see them, the swerve would be to go with Asuka, but I don't even think that's beneficial to anybody at this point. I don't think Bianca either beating Asuka or them having a competitive match kind of out of nowhere and having to kind of build a feud kind of out of bare bones is good. They can do it, but I don't think it will be good, especially with a lot of things appearing on Raw.
Yeah. Keep her off Raw, please.
I think you go for the Bianca versus Sasha. I mean, this is an opportunity to have two women of color in the, you know, rightfully in a main event slot at WrestleMania. And it's a once in a lifetime thing. And I think you do it for the moment. And I think you do it for the history. And I think you do it for the future more so than anything. Just so people can at least see, like, yo, we're making these, you know, progression moving forward, all these other things, and we're putting these people in great positions and roles. Also, I think it'll be a much better match. Sasha versus Bianca. Sasha's done really well with everything that she's, I mean, storylines, matches, yeah. But you know, I think she's done really, really well in terms of these matches, and it'll be great.
Yeah, all due respect to Carmella, do Sasha a favor and put her in there with an athlete. You know what I mean? Like, and even as somebody who's a big fan of Bayley, I think that whatever Bayley doesn't have in athleticism, she makes up for it in every other way. Like, mm-hmm. So those matches are still really good and physical, but no, put Sasha in there with somebody who can throw Sasha around a little bit. Like, who can make her work. And not that she doesn't work hard, but we just don't get that a lot. Like, I think that Charlotte's really athletic, but, you know, they've done that a million times. Like, put Sasha in there with somebody who's going to push her to maybe do some different things. I think the biggest thing about it is you want Bianca, just like with Bayley, to be able to talk and somebody to talk back to her and tell her why it's not her time. And I think you can get that out of Sasha without necessarily turning her, because even though Sasha's a face, Sasha ain't never no damn face.
Right.
Sasha is in the Sasha business, and that's why she's so appealing. So, yeah, I think that you get those two in there. And there are the obvious parallels of two super athletic, super attractive, wildly popular Black women going at it for the title. You know, Sasha being the standard bearer for women's wrestling, at the very least, you know, North American women's wrestling for the last 5, 6, 7 years. And then Bianca being, and again, not that Sasha's outdated at all, but Bianca being that new prototype that Sasha birthed, like that, like, you know, the Biancas, the Embers, the Reyes, like these big, strong athletes, like who really get at it, like in the weight room and on the track. All of a sudden being this new crop of talent. And how does Sasha compare to that? How does Sasha react to that? Like, I think that's the match. And then, like you said, Raw is shenanigans more often than it needs to be. SmackDown plays it simple, but Raw, they just want to be crazy, man. And really, they've, maybe by necessity, but they have made Asuka look really silly. Whether it's her, she shouldn't be the first one to be scared of Alexa Bliss. That should have happened with 8 people before Asuka.
Right.
And then Asuka has to adjust to it. Like, you don't do that to your champion. You got her playing hot potato with the tag titles while Ric Flair is trying to smash a facsimile of his daughter. Like, it's a mess. And yeah, you don't want your Royal Rumble winner all of a sudden thrown into that mix. I think the Sasha thing is way more one-on-one and straightforward.
Okay, real quick for a break. What Stan Army is going to be worse during Sasha Bianca?
There are too many bored grown men in Sasha's. They're going to be horrible. They are going to be, you know, I don't know if y'all like, one of the worst things about Twitter is like, you start to get some engagement on a tweet, you start to get followers. Like, you know, you're like, man, I can capitalize off this a little bit. Maybe there's somebody in my area. So you see the Abby from a distance, you're like, oh, she looked kind of good. Click on it. dude named Gregory, Sasha Abbey. Wow. I'm just like, come on.
And his name is crew member. His name is crew member 5546 or some shit like that.
Exactly, man. So no, it's gonna be the Sasha stands are gonna be way worse because they've been performing their evil on the internet for so long. They don't know how to take their foot off the gas.
Mm. Bianca, I'm praying for you.
Oh boy,
I'm hoping. I'm just hoping all bases, all stand bases. It was like, listen, we understand what this is.
What's gonna happen? And when it happens, I want everyone to come back here on the show, and we're gonna talk about it. Someone's gonna say, "Is Bianca even really black?" And then that's gonna start the war off.
Oh my god! No! Even worse. Here's what's gonna happen, because the world's gonna eat itself when somebody says Bianca's ratchet.
Oh,
that's what's gonna happen. Yeah. And then we're gonna have those flashbacks to NXT, and the world is gonna swallow itself because, oh boy, a majority white male fan base having to choose between two black women. Ooh. And feeling like they have to look for things to pick apart between the two of them, it's gonna get nasty. I might pull up on the Capitol.
Vince, I'm weak.
Vince sees dollar signs right now just from that description. When we get back, we're gonna quickly run through Raw and what a show that was. It won't take us that long, so we'll be right back on the A Show.
Whoa, relax. I know who you are. But the only reason that I came here is because a good friend wanted to be on Misty B.
It's like Bad Bunny had something up his sleeve. In the form of Damien Priest, and it is written in fire, the NXT superstar Damien
Priest.
Shout out his first appearance on Raw being like, my Puerto Rican friend. Like, there was so much, like, I'm not saying it's necessarily a bad thing, but like, there was so much other stuff that went into the Damien Priest character in NXT, and then it's like, my friend, and he's like, here he is. He's also Latin. He's also Puerto Rican. And he's my guy. And I was just like, you know what? Fair. Why not?
Of course, we are back on the A Show. We're here with CeeHawk, of course, and Meelz. Talking about Monday Night Raw. Obviously, SmackDown was a go-home show. So we talked about a lot of things that happened on that on the Royal Rumble. You can definitely check that out before the break. But we're talking about Raw. And let's start off with the big news here. I mean, Bad Bunny appeared at Royal Rumble, had a really cool thing happen at Royal Rumble. Splashed off the top rope. That motherfucker's crazy. I don't know if any of you have gotten on the top rope of any wrestling ring. It's really fucking high. I maybe it's just me. I'm scared of heights.
No, I have not had that pleasure. Unlike you, who have been to several WWE 2K events and
That shit ain't fun. I stayed away from the top rope.
I'm Dean Malenko to the bullshit. I want to stay right there on that mat, baby.
Exactly. I'm not jumping on that. So Bad Bunny's definitely, he must have been on some type of drug, mind-altering drug. But of course, he showed up on Royal Rumble and on Raw, and he introduced and helped debut Damian Priest. Now, there's been a lot of conversation about whether this is a good thing or whether, you know, people should be afraid or worried. I mean, I think that this wasn't a bad thing for Damian. I mean, it's a lot better than the way that they debut a lot of these guys. I just don't want it to become like a kiss demon thing. I want him to actually have his own character. But I mean, they let him go off for the past for those two nights where he was on the Royal Rumble, had a really great showing, and on Raw where he beat The Miz. I thought he did really well. I'm really excited for the prospects of Damian Priest, who I thought and we thought were going to debut on SmackDown a couple of weeks ago.
He seems like SmackDown-y.
his white cousin Baron Corbin's on that show, so I think they had to.
Right. I was just like,
I'm with you though. Like, you do get worried about stuff like Dale Torborg, the Kiss Demon stuff, but I think that I prefer this to what happens so often where your big celebrity meets one of your biggest stars and they're supposed to be cool because they're both at the top of what they do. Like, I was telling Wade Keller, like, Wade, I'm not sure if you know the extent to which people are attracted to Damian Priest.
Yeah.
Like, if you check your timeline when he's on, women go insane for that man. You know what I mean? And he has an unconventional look. You know, he's a damn near 7 foot Puerto Rican guy. Like those don't exist. And so, you know, you add in that tattoos, the voice, the gear, like you understand what the attraction is. Bad Bunny, attractive to women in an unconventional way. So I think there's a bond over that. You got, and I tell you what, I mean, you know, you in New York, I'm in Texas. Who the Latin women like is typically who you want to support. Like, it's just going to work out for everybody. That's where the money's going to be. That's where the attention's going to be. You're going to see some dancing you like. You just kind of rock with that. So I'm not saying that this was Vince's idea. Whoever pitched it in the back needs some money.
Absolutely.
Like,
this is legitimately money about to say that.
Yeah, because he don't know what's going on. Like, because remember the whole thing with Gail Kim, when somebody had to, JR had to show him the Asian porn, I don't know what they showed Vince. Like, I don't know, gave him a Sex Mex link. It's possible, but I think it's a good matchup. And I don't think that Damian Priest is, he's done so much good work on his own without having a co-signer that I think if Bad Bunny doesn't show up again, he's still going to be in a good position.
Yeah, I mean, just think of the matchups he has already on Raw. Obviously, you think of The Miz, who it seems like he's going to be paired with for the foreseeable future. Bobby Lashley is something that we could see other than, you know, you got Drew McIntyre. We also have Keith Lee, who is on Raw as well, and they've had bangers on NXT before. There are a lot of ways that he can go. Raw is looking like, again, a show full of big men because Braun is also on Raw as well. So there could be a lot of passages for Damian Priest to be successful. I honestly do think the upside for him is very high, especially because WWE does attract the Hispanic Latin community. That's some of their biggest audience. I think that there is obviously a place there for him if they decide to push him the right way.
Absolutely. And once again, just a raise to whoever put the deal together with Bad Bunny, because quite honestly, that's the most current mainstream thing that WWE has landed on. When it was, we didn't get like Bad Bunny, like, you know, 10 years from now. It's like, you know, like Latin Grammy award winning, but he like won his Grammy in like 2002 or something. Like, they got him at the peak of his powers, kind of everything's rolling, everything's smoking. They know he's a great wrestling fan. He came both days, which I just expected Rumble. So the fact that he showed up for Monday Night Raw too, I was just like, wow. And, you know, he wants to be involved. And I think that's amazing. And to anyone who is a, you know, who thinks otherwise, I feel sorry for you. I feel sorry for you.
Let's go back down through Raw. I thought it was okay. Show Meelz, you were a little bit more sour on it. Cam, how'd you feel about Raw this week?
It's a misses. Like, I like the Edge stuff. I don't like that Sheamus has been Drew's boy week in and week out, gave him the motivation to win the title back. No real signs of dissension, then all of a sudden kicks his head off.
Yeah.
Because Edge said it was going to happen. Like, you build to that. Like, you don't have to throw that out there that fast. The Alexa stuff, we had a kid call the Torch show last night, this kid Kyle, and just loves everything that Alexa is doing and thinks is the coolest thing. I was like, Kyle, that's cool, but I think it's so fucking stupid and uneven. and granted, like, clearly, that's what they need for somebody to love it. I think Alexa is working really hard at what they ask her to do. Like, she's dialed in, but I you have to suspend disbelief so many times in one segment. And there's no real parameters on what she does. Like, I don't know. I think that it's clearly playing up to a Fiend Randy thing, but hopefully they get through with that. I don't like Oscar being made the fool while Charlotte deals with this stuff with Rick and Lacey. So there's that. I'm absolutely loving John Morrison, though. As somebody who always thought he was the biggest cornball, he's working so hard. He's working so hard to make this thing work. He's throwing in Spanish. Like,
that's from, he's great. That's from his Lucha Underground days. I was like, oh yeah, he definitely knows all about that.
Yeah.
You know, and all that.
And then I don't know what is going on with Matt Riddle, though. Like,
listen,
you have Matt Riddle beat everybody in the Hurt Business,
yeah,
and then last a half hour in the Rumble, and then Lashley was like, nah, we done with that.
That is my biggest sticking point on the run sheet this week, is the Hurt Business. We are in week 58, 67 of them breaking up and having problems, but booking would not let you know that because they win every single match that they have. I think that there's something to be said to have a dominant faction. I have no problem with a dominant faction. That's actually dope. They don't have many of those within this company. However, when you push a dissension angle and nothing comes of it, it starts to look like what we wanted from Sheamus, but like the other way, strangely enough, where it's like, okay, Sheamus was too fast. This is taking too long. I felt that, and you know, feelings on Riddle outside the ring aside, they are pushing this guy. He was eliminated after Lashley was. He was in the last, what, 8 competitors on Sunday night? Looked great. Had, you know, had bouts with Seth Rollins and Bryan within that same thing. And then you have him lose within 3 minutes. The one thing we haven't touched on is that the match ended and it should have been a DQ for Lashley, but they counted it as a win.
Yeah. It was weird. He choked that man out, hanging over the rope. And then proceeded to just beat him down.
Yeah.
Like, I don't, it's got to be, I mean, it feels like a vote of no confidence that you developed for a guy overnight. Like, I don't know. Did that court summons come in? Because it's possible.
Well, he just, Fightful, I think, just announced that he resigned. I think this is literally 10 minutes ago as we were doing the show. They announced that he resigned a deal through 2023. So it's definitely not them not having any confidence in him because he just resigned. It seems to be. It looks like there's two schools of thought here on Riddle and Lashley. There might be one side that wants Lashley to look as strong as possible, but not give him the fucking belt for some strange reason. And then there's another side of people that want Riddle to be pushed, but know that he has issues outside the ring and knows what that would look like. And it's like, you don't want Lashley to look stupid, but you don't want Riddle to look weird. So Riddle ends up beating up guys or looking good against guys that Lashley never even gets to face. It's very weird.
Yeah. I just think overall the storytelling on Monday Night Raw is the weirdest part of the show. And I think when you piece apart kind of every segment that we're kind of running through, it's kind of been the story that like doesn't make sense. And I think it's mainly because WWE stories, I mean, typical stories, you do storytelling, you kind of have a conclusion, you have a resolution, you have this point where it peaks, you have this point where you don't. But when you're writing like weekly TV, you're just like, nah, let's see what happens this week. Let's do this week, and let's do this week. And you continue to do that thing. Like, I think, you know, beyond the Hurt Business stuff, once again, like we're talking about it, every week is a similar thing. But when you typically write out the story, I'm assuming the target is WrestleMania or the night after WrestleMania. But, like, at least plan it out accordingly. You know what I'm saying? Like, let's not do this thing every week. Even the Alexa Bliss thing, right? Like, I think the great thing for that character would be that it manages, she's completely involved, and it doesn't look like, if I had to pick, I don't think the Fiend is returning until WrestleMania. But
yeah,
you at least have it's weird some.
I'm sorry to interrupt, but like, it's weird how they've shown restraint on bringing the Fiend back, more restraint than they had with Sasha, who was legitimately injured,
right?
And like had her neck broken, and she was back 2 weeks later. Like, they've shown so much restraint on The Fiend, and I get that they probably did that because they were overexposing him. I think that was the main issue. But it's like, it's like you said, like the stop and start is so weird.
Yeah, I think it's because they, weeks ago, I wish they put as much effort they did in this Randy Fiend storyline as they do, even like half the effort as they do in other storylines, because they don't really tell a similar story. Like, they kind of, They can do things like have him off TV and it would be meaningful, but you have all these like things that like hint every week he might be coming. You have Alexa Bliss spin out, you know, black shit on top of the rope to end Raw, and you continue to have that story, but you don't tell that to other people. Like, you kind of leave him out to dry, and you kind of, you know, the like look at the let's take a thing for the Lana and Naomi thing. Like, so Lana returns. To, like, no fanfare, by the way. She returns in a Rumble with just no fanfare. She returns. She's been getting, like, axed for weeks. She got her leg broken before a tag team title match. She shows back to no thing and just shows up randomly and wins a tag team title shot with a completely different partner. And we're just supposed to be like, yay! But it's like, that doesn't... Why? Like, why should I care? Like, she doesn't even look like she cares that much. Like... And the Drew and Sheamus thing, like, the only thing that I had issue with is like that it happened so soon, like, and they could have took some time to like actually like flesh out that story a little bit. But I don't know if they're going a different direction with Drew for Mania, so they're like, let's get this Sheamus thing out the way. I don't know.
what is Drew's direction? It's not Lashley, right? Like, it can't be.
Yeah, Sheamus is like Elimination Chamber, you figure, right?
Yeah.
Like, that's there. I mean, it could be Drew. I had Lashley winning the Rumble, not really considering Edge until, you know, kind of the end of it. But I had Lashley winning because I thought you've had him beat up everybody for the last year. Like, he's been the man. Nobody can even snip the U.S. title. So I was like, by hook or by crook, on the Rumble, maybe they get the U.S. belt off of him.
Right.
But then he wins the Rumble.
Yeah, because the week they had the Riddle match. And I was so sure on that Raw a week ago, I was like, oh, they're going to go all in with Bobby, give Riddle the title, because the U.S. title, let's be honest, it's an albatross. If you have it, you're not going anywhere. So what's wrong with Riddle having it, right? Like, they obviously don't want Riddle to have a main title right now. Just give that to him. He can just face whoever the fuck. But then they had Bobby get eliminated. It's super strange. And I mean, to go back to the Hurt Business, they had a tag match against Lucha House Party, which was way too fucking long for considering how dominant they are as a squad. They do the Cedric and Shelton thing, and then they're cool at the end.
I mean, they're gonna do the same thing next week. So
it makes no sense.
They're gonna do the same thing next week.
And people had their issues with, you know, Heyman, his booking. But at least things built to things on TV, at least, you know, like their pay-per-views, their matches on pay-per-view were at least very good to passable. But the TV, they always had a pay-per-view caliber match. They didn't do what they did this week, or he didn't do what they did this week with the Riddle Bobby stuff, or even the tag team title match, or even that triple threat match, which was like, again, WWE booking 101, which is the distraction made sure, like, Charlotte dead ass tagged out and left.
You got to follow that.
Like, what?
You got it.
Like, bitch, you was undefeated for like 2 years. I'm
assuming they're building dissension between Asuka, because at some point before the match, Asuka was like, yo, all I know is I'm doing good. You better get it together. Because that lady, which she specifically says, that lady that keeps coming out during this match.
Asuka could not remember her lines in that promo, and I was like, please stop giving her these dumbass promos to remember. I like just Japanese, yo. I liked it better that way. Like, you had more like intensity and heart when you did that. Like, I like when they allowed her to speak in her native language. I thought it was a really novel way to present her. Now, I'm hoping for heel Asuka again, because I don't think the face thing's working for her anymore.
She can do.
She's just looking a little. Yeah, she's looking silly, to say the least.
Definitely take advantage of face Asuka. Hence my make it make sense moment a couple years ago.
So quickly, we don't know where Drew's going for Mania. I think that's up in the air. Could it be Keith Lee? You guys think?
I feel like they finally have to turn him, because they had them go face-face right before the Goldberg thing. Really, really good match.
Yeah.
I don't know. Does Keith Lee come back with a goatee and a mustache to signify that he's a heel? I mean, aesthetically, I think that's the best match on Raw. He's done the AJ thing. The Sheamus thing doesn't feel big time. You know, Ali's not there yet. I think that's as good a thing as any, with Lashley being right there in the wings as well.
I honestly think this might be Galaxy Brain, Priest and Lashley, and Priest does get the U.S. title.
I honestly can't tell with the U.S. title.
He's the newest.
Yeah.
Lashley is beating everybody. Lashley has hooked on that full Nelson and just decided, I'm beating everyone. So I can't really tell anymore. It's going to be weird when he loses it, because he's won so much. And you know it's going to be like a one and done type of thing.
But the thing that's weird about that is that, like, usually you'd build like a Brock or somebody or a Roman to make a guy. But it's weird that, like, I'm like, so you beat Lashley, who was the mid-cards guy. Are you the mid-cards guy now? Like, I don't know, like, the levels of what you do. Because when Bobby loses that title, I don't know what he does. Like, he Drew's already beaten him, and then they literally stop interacting after that. And then you don't want him to beat Riddle, or you don't want Riddle to beat him. You don't want, you know, anyone else to beat him. What if they had Cedric Alexander do it? Oh, he already beat him too. Did he beat all? Yep. He beat up all his homeboy.
Beat all three of them except Lashley in that same night. Yep.
Oh my god, that's bad. So are we thinking Asuka Charlotte for WrestleMania too?
I think think so. I think it's Asuka getting her win back from Mania a few years back. I do see that being the match, though.
I'm worried about that, Cam. I'm going to tell you that. I never bet against Charlotte when it comes to shows like this, man. I'm concerned.
That is who Vince McMahon, that's his familiar spot. If anything, you want to be Vince McMahon's familiar spot. But yeah, when all else fails, put the belt on Charlotte. That is how it goes.
Very concerned. But one thing I am not concerned with is the fact that we had a great show today and everyone's going to love it. So thank you, Cam, for being on the show. Is there anything that you want to plug on the way out?
Let's see. Every Wednesday at 6:30 Eastern, 5:30 Central, Travis Bryant, myself, and Rich Fan host the Pro Wrestling Torch East Coast cast, taking your calls, voicemails, and emails about the week in wrestling. Goes 6:30 Eastern right up until the start of NXT and Impact. I'm sorry, NXT and Dynamite.
Same show. Same show, Cam. This is the same show.
Well, shit. That's going to be, let's see, every Wednesday at eastcoastcast.com. Outside of that, most recently on the South Congress podcast, as far as wrestling related stuff, did an interview last Thursday with AJ Gray, independent wrestler. I was wrestling two shows for GCW's Fight Forever event. They had a 24-hour live stream, both YouTube and Fight TV, showcasing a lot of the best talents in independent wrestling. If you want a unique wrestling interview, AJ ate a rack of ribs the whole interview.
Wow.
This is the issue with being like actual friends with wrestlers. They get too comfortable. And so they do things like eat a rack of ribs while you're talking to them. So there's a lot of, that's my man. But yeah, outside of that, Instagram, Twitter, just CeeHawk, CeeHawk. If you want to see somebody make a wrestling fan angry simply for stating what it is they're seeing, you can see a lot of that.
Shout out to Wrestling Otaku too, man.
Oh man, listen, forget about my stuff. If you want to be entertained weekly, go to YouTube and subscribe to the Wrestling Otaku's page. It's OTAKU. I have a bad habit of enjoying things that might not actually be informative or detailed or even true, but are entertaining. There is nothing entertaining like a 30-something-year-old man doing his YouTube show out of his grandparents' house, stating how much he dislikes women and WWE. Please like, subscribe, recommend to your friends.
Well, listen, I watched a couple of his videos, namely the ones where he disses you, because I had to see what the beef was about. This guy,
oh God,
this guy is unhinged. All right,
and he called all my followers coons. It was amazing. I was like, this is great.
I'm afraid for you. He's going like, I'm very afraid for you. But I don't worry, because I know that you know you work out every day. You're very strong.
I keep that thing on me is what I do. Better leave me alone. Texas.
Oh my God. But thank you, Cam, for being on the show. As always, you can follow us at the A Show RNC on Twitter. Follow me at OGJohnny5, Meelz at Meelz TV. Of course, we have shows such as the War Report. Me and Cyrus, we are starting to begin the rumblings of our New Japan show. That will be coming out very, very soon. We'll give you more details on that. But of course, as always, please wash your hands, wear a damn mask. Until next week, thank you for listening to The A Show. We'll see you next week. That's it right there. Let me see something. Pull back, baby. Talk to me nice. Look, perk, dirty, perk, dreaming. Room, more cloud nine. Know that I'm dreaming. Know that I'm dreaming. Four, 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 four,